begin with a poem called The Catch. For you, the catch wasn't something caught, not word or contender, attention or fire, not the almost missed train or the sort of wave surfers might wait an entire lifetime for. Not the promise that leaves the old man adrift for days, his boat creaking miles offshore. Nor what cleaves the heart in two that left your throat parched and mute for taking pill after yellow-green pill, the black-blue taste, the price you paid to kill, the two-part sadness to one-part anger. No, the catch was what you could never let go. It's what you carried and still do. I tend to start readings from this book with poems about depression, partly because it means we go on an upward trajectory as the reading progresses. But it's also because I think poetry is perhaps especially suited to talking about things that are often difficult to talk about and things that maybe we don't talk about. And it's heartening to see, I think, of late, more and more poets sort of writing about mental illness. And this next poem, I wrote really on the back of a dear family member of mine experiencing a particularly bad bout of clinical depression. And I really wanted to kind of access that idea of poetry as a spell or charm, you know, that traditional kind of almost ancient idea, I suppose, of poetry as something that can act as a warning or as a kind of defence even against the worst. The Irish poet Michael Longley said, "If I knew where poems came from, I'd go there," which I think is a lovely statement, but in this case, perhaps not true. That's probably all I need to say about this poem. It's called Hound. When it comes, and I know how it comes from nowhere, out of night like a shadow falling on streets, how it waits by the door in silence, a single black thought, its empty face. Don't let it tie you down to the house. Don't let it slope upstairs to spend hours coiled next to your bed. But force the thing out, make it trudge for miles in cold and wind and sleet. Have it follow you, the faithful pet it pretends to be, this mutt like a poor man's Cerberus. Tell it where to get off when it hangs on with its coaxing look. Leave it tethered to a lamppost and forget those pangs of guilt. No, it's no dog there, but a phantom. Fur so dark, it gives back nothing. See your hand pass through its come-and-go presence. Air of self-satisfied deception. Just as the future bursts in on the present, its big I am, and that sulking hound goes to ground again. As I am for my sins, a fan of Liverpool Football Club, I have to apologise before most readings, to be honest, for that very reason. And I had what many people in this audience will probably consider the dubious honour of seeing this next poem feature in the official club magazine. I can only think it was a very quiet week. So Gerard probably wasn't available for an interview. Luis Suarez hadn't bitten anybody, so they just thought, poet, yeah, that'll do. Got a bit of space going. The poem really is just about that kind of experience that many of you may have had at a big sporting event, where you kind of get sucked into this sense of community and belonging. And particularly at a football match and going to Anfield, the home of Liverpool Football Club, I've experienced that. And then when the whistle blows, you know, when full time comes around, suddenly that dissipates and it's kind of gone. And I suppose this poem was just trying to capture something of that, looking back to the first game that I attended at Anfield with my dad back when I was a 10-year-old. It's just called This Is Anfield. Living up to its fabled buzz, the cup roared and rose even before kickoff. Down in the main stand I watched, John Barnes adjusting his captain's band on the flawless turf. Waves of red, it rose and rose. A kid in that season's kit, I grinned with a kind of borrowed pride, belonging without belonging. My dad and brother craning to see McManaman darting, how Fowler ignited strike after strike. Half time over, and a flying header left the keeper without a chance. The place erupted. I still remember it like that. The luminous pitch, echo of the terraces, players floodlit beneath an October sky. An ordinary game, solid win, save for one kid looking on in wonder. So yes, as Janet mentioned, a large part of the book is given over to a sequence of really, I guess you'd call them character portraits from the history of the football club. And after I'd written Mrs. Anfield, I kind of settled on the idea of writing these poems, because not so much that I wanted to celebrate Liverpool Football Club in particular, it was more that I wanted to kind of access, through poetry, the way in which sport can often be a kind of microcosm of our kind of little human dramas. And I find those kind of links between sport and creativity and life more generally particularly fascinating. So if you'll indulge me, I'll just read a couple more from this sequence. Next one, Bill Shankly, who was the original governor, as some of you may know, who kind of propelled Liverpool from hopefuls to dominant football club in these isles. And he was one of those managers that was given to these little kind of philosophical pronouncements. And the great thing as a poet, obviously, is that you get to steal things from other people. So this poem essentially consists of him saying very smart things, for which I can take no credit whatsoever. It's called Bill Shankly. Always pass the ball forward, lads. Always pass to a red shirt. A football team's like a piano. You need eight to carry it and three who can play the damn thing. Ours is a simple sport, the give and take of passes, control of the ball. Make yourself available. It is that simple. Thing is, some know the rules, but they don't know the game. Lads, you'll do well if you remember two things. Believe that you're the best, and then make sure of it. At a club, there's a holy trinity. The players, the manager, and the supporters. Football is not a matter of life and death. It is much more important than that. The trouble with you, son, is that all your brains are in your head. Obviously, football's kind of mired in big money now. You know, the top clubs spend big, the turnovers are insane, the players come and go, and it's lost some of its original soul, you know, kind of the spirit of football, I suppose, that working class kind of terraces football that people look back fondly on. But I always think of Kenny Dalglish, really, as a figure who kind of gave his all for his club. I remember after, you know, the Hillsborough disaster, he attended every single one of the funerals of the 96. And whatever you think of as a player, and, you know, the player for Liverpool Football Club in particular, I think he was a man of principle in many ways, and gave a lot of himself to the club. And really, this poem just celebrates that. Kenny Dalglish. Day breaks to heavy clouds over Anfield Road, the Sabbath beyond that echoing afternoon. Gates opened, the faithful bring flowers, wreaths, notes, sisters, mothers, fathers weeping, placing them in the goal mouth, the 18-yard box, past the halfway line. You'd think, for all the world, it had snowed. Then one man, making no fuss, steps up, sits down two teddy bears gifted by his kids, a man who's performed miracles on this field, resurrected hopes, who pays respects to everyone, not in duty's name, but love's. They supported Liverpool Football Club. It's the turn of the club to support them. I always liked Ted Hughes' idea poetic forms as kind of traps. You know, he did go around the countryside killing quite a few things, so I suppose it's an apt metaphor for it. But for a long time, I struggled, as a poet who does tend to write in form, to work out what the sestina was for. And I just thought I'd never really write Sestina. Some of you, most of you may know that Sestina is a devilishly sort of complex form in many ways, lots of repetitions through it, quite long-winded as well, so you know, you're apt to bore your reader if you write one. But eventually, I think it was around the time of the 2015 election, I struggled on the Conservative Party manifesto. And suddenly I realised that actually the Sestina did have a purpose for me. And that purpose was one of a kind of barely concealed rage. And I thought I can empty this into this form and it will contain it quite nicely. So I took the rather kind of vacuous title of that particular manifesto as a title for this Sestina. And I suppose when I perform it, I feel like I'm channeling the spirit of David Cameron. It's titled, Building a Brighter, More Secure Future. You must understand what we are building is not the housing we promised, not a hospital or school. It is a brighter notion, an idea written, where more food banks will flourish, but for those secure, there is no cause for alarm. The future is a place where the rich hand the future to the poor, in which the great buildings of Canary Wharf, climbing secure above Tower Hamlets, offer up a glut of wealth to the unfortunate, more than you can imagine. This is a brighter future, we promise. It is much brighter than a concept like equality. A future cannot be built on that. We all want more, and some people are better at building wealth or else inheriting it. So a tax for those who are beyond secure is unfair. They made their money secure through society and being brighter or otherwise having been born to a fortune will make sure that in the future sometime this trickles down. As a building stands firm, you have our word that more will come to those without. Making more is paramount. To secure this, in the meantime, we have cut buildings steadily to public services that the brighter, more secure have no need for. In the future, you may need them, but the future is a notion, distant and unknowable. It is a distraction. What we are promising is more. What we promise is a secure future, and this will be true for some. More secure as the great sun of the city shines brighter, casts its shadow. Look what we are building. This is our future. What we have is a mandate to fulfill, building a Britain more secure. And for us, it will be brighter. Thank you very much.